Craig, at the start of the year, the Bank of Canada policy rate was at 0.25%. We are into October, and the policy rate sits at 3.25%. Is Canada's economy where the bank wants us to be? What are you seeing?
Well, what we're seeing is the Bank of Canada delivering an unprecedented speed of tightening of monetary policy, with interest rates rising extremely rapidly because it has fallen behind the curve on inflation. And once inflation is out of hand, it's actually very hard for the central bank to wrestle inflation back down. And it does take time for the changes in its interest rates to have an impact. So given the speed at which the Bank of Canada has increased interest rates, it's still very early days. So when we look at the state of the economy, when we look at inflation, it looks like we may be seeing inflation having peaked, but it's still running at dramatically above the 2% mark, which the Bank of Canada wants to get it down to. And at the same time, we are seeing the interest rate sensitive segments of the economy responding to the higher interest rates. We're seeing a pullback in the Canadian residential real estate market. We are seeing the knock-on effect of that. When you have weaker home sales, that translates to weaker consumer spending on furniture, appliances, on renovation activity, and that has all started. But from the point of view of the Bank of Canada, they're at their last decision, they signaled that they aren't done raising interest rates. And so the market is currently assigning a probability of about a 60% chance that we're going to see a half a percentage point increase on October 26th. So it looks like the overnight rate will get up to 3.75% by the end of October. And then I think the question is going to be, does the Bank of Canada signal a pause at that point, given how far they've taken rates and the fact that monetary policy is now in a restrictive sense, it's a stance, it is applying brakes to the economy, and it's going to continue to apply brakes as we go forward, or will the Bank of Canada feel it needs to push rates even higher? I think that one of the concerns is that the US Federal Reserve just recently signaled that it's going to take interest rates well through the 4% mark. So the question is, will the Bank of Canada follow suit?
A few things to get into there. You had mentioned that it takes time for these rates to have an impact. As you've said, we have been seeing the impacts to housing. How long before we see the full effect of these rates?
Well, the full impact of changes in interest rates are actually felt over a period of 12 to 18 months. So it will take a considerable amount of time before we actually get the full fallout in the adjustment in monetary policy. And to understand why there's such a lag, you know, a good example is in the mortgage market, for example. When interest rates rise, you know, some people, their mortgage will respond immediately. They'll feel the bite immediately as you know, if they have an adjustable rate mortgage, their mortgage borrowing costs will be going up as the Bank of Canada has been raising interest rates. If they have a fixed mortgage, it'll only be when the mortgage comes up for renewal that they'll suddenly feel the bite of the higher debt service costs. So the economy isn't going to feel it immediately, the full effect. But I think that the speed at which the Bank of Canada raised rates, it means that we are going to see it, you know, in the monthly data as we move forward. And I actually think that we're going to see a lot of weakening in Canadian demand, which is what the Bank of Canada is attempting to do. We're going to see it through the next 3 to 4 quarters. And you know, the challenge is that's going to come at the same time that the U.S. economy is feeling the bite from the U.S. Federal Reserve raising interest rates. And then Canada will import the weakening in U.S. demand because Canada is a major trading nation and the U.S. is the destination for the bulk of our exports. And so, you know, in a sense, Canada imports some of the weakness that the U.S. Federal Reserve is going to engineer south of the border. And then the other dimension here, which is actually outside of the central bank, is that in the second quarter of this year, we had unprecedented amount of inventory accumulation. And it, you know, in the second quarter, we've never seen businesses add as much to inventories as they did. And I think part of it was because of the weakening in global demand and weakness in demand in the United States. I think some of it was because supply chains were improving. And that's a positive because part of the inflation problem we're having is because of disrupted supply chains. But as supply chains were normalizing, I think a lot of businesses suddenly found that orders they had previously put in were suddenly filled and products showed up, and this left them with a lot of additional inventories. And the problem is that when businesses end up with an excess of inventories, when they work down those inventories, it acts as a drag on economic growth. And so I personally think that we're going to see the economy weaken from a combination of a big swing in inventories and the impact of the higher interest rates here and abroad.
You mention inventories in your most recent fall economic update as the cause for a recession, more so than rising interest rates and high inflation. Now, if we're to take a look at our neighbors to the south, they've already experienced two back-to-back months of economic decline. How accurate are those metrics? And tell us about why you're looking at different elements here in Canada.
Well, I think that what we want to sort of focus on is, you know, is the Canadian economy going to experience a contraction? And I think the answer is yes. And when that contraction occurs, I think that it's you know, because I think that the economic contraction is going to happen for more than for at least two quarters, and I think that there's going to be, you know, enough economic weakness that it will meet the definition of a recession. However, when we talk about how will this downturn feel to Canadians, right? Because, you know, we measure recessions, or we basically evaluate recessions on the basis of what happens to economic growth, right? If the economy contracts and it's a broad contraction and it's a deep contraction and it lasts for a couple of quarters, well, we call that a recession. And we measure that off of gross domestic product. But the fact of the matter is nobody eats real GDP, right? What matters to Canadians is jobs. And if the economy is weak, and even if the economy has a contraction, but a lot of the swing in the economy is coming from a drop in inventories, and you don't see a large increase in unemployment, then for many Canadians, it isn't going to feel like the economy is that bad. And one of the key issues that we have at the moment, when I talk to businesses from coast to coast, is labor shortages. Like, we currently have a million unfilled jobs in this country. And when I talk to businesses and I talk to CEOs and management teams, and I've been, you know, for the last 3 months, I've been warning them that we could have a recession in this country. They've said, you know, the dominant response has been, yes, we understand there could be a turn in the business cycle because of what central banks are doing. But you know what our biggest problem is? It's labor shortages. And the message they tell me is, if the weak economic weakness is likely to be short-lived, if it's going to be weakness that's only going to last two or three quarters, then they are unlikely to start shedding workers. They're unlikely to lay off a lot of workers because of how hard it's been to actually recruit and retain workers in the recent environment. Labor shortages have been their real problem. So if businesses actually act the way they've been communicating and they hoard labor in response to a period of economic weakness, we don't see a large increase in unemployment. Well, that means that any economic downturn is going to be relatively mild. And from a point of view of Canadians, it's not going to feel that bad because jobs will still be available.
Craig, you had mentioned earlier that the Fed has been going a lot higher than we had anticipated. I guess in keeping with everything that you had just mentioned, does this now change the landing? For the longest time, we were talking about a soft landing.
Well, a lot depends on how high the U.S. Federal Reserve does take interest rates. The assumption that I had was that we would see that the Bank of Canada, the Federal Reserve, would both raise interest rates in October. We'd see the Fed funds rate and the overnight rate get up to 3.75, maybe up to 4%. But I didn't expect central banks to be signaling that they would be going well beyond the 4% mark. And at their latest FOMC meeting, the U.S. Federal Reserve members, the voting members of the FOMC committee, when the meeting was completed, they provide where they think the Fed funds rate is going to be at the end of this year and the end of next year. And in terms of the median expectation of the Fed members, they basically signaled they expected that the Fed funds rate would be 4.5% by the end of this year. And based on their expectations for next year, it implied that they could see the Fed funds rate getting up to 4.75%. And when you think that the Federal Reserve is going from close to zero all the way up to they're now thinking about taking it as close to 5%, you have to think that would lead to a hard landing in the U.S. economy. And if there's a very old adage, if the U.S. catches a cold, Canada gets pneumonia. And the reality is, if the U.S. has a hard landing, Canada's going to have a hard landing as well. My hope is that what the Fed is telegraphing isn't actually what they do. I actually think that both central banks have already done enough. I think the elements of inflation coming down towards the 2% targets are already falling into place. First of all, I think supply chains are in fact improving and normalizing. Globally, financial markets are now pricing in recessions in Europe and increasingly recessions in North America. Global demand for raw materials, commodity prices is falling. So we're seeing lower prices for commodities. When we get past the 1 year mark of the 1 year anniversary of the start of the war in Ukraine, the year-over-year comparison on a lot of the inflation metrics are going to improve. And remember, we measure inflation as the year-over-year change in prices. And the very sharp increase in interest rates we've already seen, as we discussed, with a lag, the increases that we've had are going to slow down economic growth. So I actually think that central banks, are likely to deliver a further hike at their next meeting. But my hope is that they don't just keep pushing interest rates ever higher, because I think if they actually paused and gave the tightening that they've already done some time to work, I actually think we'd see inflation very rapidly coming back down in the direction of the 2% target. And that would limit the downside risks in terms of, how hard a landing we might have. But if the Federal Reserve actually delivers what the FOMC members are currently signaling, then I definitely think that the argument for a mild recession in Canada, becomes, there's a material risk that it goes from being a mild contraction to something more severe.